I met Jenny Devon at the Wise Women Workshop at the Feminist University in Lotte, Norway in 2001, where 20 women from all over the world had been invited to participate in a series of workshops where each of us could make a positive contribution to the new century's feminist thought. I was intrigued by her theory of the matriarchal gift economy, even though I did not fully understand what she meant at the time. My first reaction was to wonder if I would be willing to give away those things that most mattered to me. My exercise at the conference of giving away my precious necklace and my poncho was futile. That was not what she meant. Except that when I had met some of the people that received the gift in international conference, they really appreciated and had not forgotten that it was my initiation in the gift economy. Back in Colombia, I realized that resources should flow where they are needed, as Mickey Cashtan rightly says, that the women of the Association of Women Heads of Family at that time earning their living by making handmade paper, living in terrible conditions in rented houses, sharing one bathroom for 70 people, and in part of the city where crime and drug addiction was the rule. What they really needed was a house, but did not have neither the money to pay for the rent nor to buy one. From the etymological point of view, ecologies come from the Greek oikos, house, and logos, science. It is therefore the science that studies the relationship of living beings with each other and with their habitat. The first task was to acquire a farm where the women could build their houses and at the same time grow their own food and had a place of their own where nobody could evict them, least of all their male companions or husbands. It was the land, the empowerment, that actually made it possible for them to have the house. It was like her body, where she could welcome a companion when she was ready and in that way manage her sexuality as well. The farm donated to build the project was in the same place where 2,000 years ago flourished a matriarchal community. The Malagana culture of Canzaterua was believed to be matriarchal and practiced the gift economy. They worshipped Mother Earth, and the goddesses were women breastfeeding and giving birth, as can be seen from the clay and gold figures found recently in newly uncovered graves. Here you can see multiple breasts. Here you can see two gold pectorals showing the head of a child inside the woman's body. This other one is a child pushing himself with his hand to be born. These figures of mothers giving birth and breastfeeding symbolize gifts received from Mother Nature and were objects of worship together with the sun and the moon. The air we breathe, the water we drink, the plants and other food that Mother Nature offered us are all gifts from her. European colonialism, accompanied by religious catechization, expelled violently this relationship with Mother Earth, as Vandana Shiva rightly put it. Colonialism established an exchange economy, gave a price for captured men as slaves and for the body of women as sex objects for the use of the patriarchal invaders. They devalue motherhood and establish patriarchal paradigms that still dominate and subvert the indigenous communities that survive to preserve their ancestral traditions. The Kogi indigenous people of the Sierra Nevada de Santa Marta are considered by scholars a matriarchal community, but if you look at them carefully, they have been hijacked by the exchange economy. The mamo or shaman is the all-powerful head of the community. He is the one that chooses the husband or his daughters according to his capacity to work. The Nachira eco-village, where mothers rule, is a modern effort to revive ancestral and indigenous customs based on the tradition of a matriarchal gift economy, giving back to mothers the control of the land so as to allow Mother Nature to give her gifts. 88 women receive as a gift from Mother Nature a sustainable eco-village. They receive from her their own organic food, grow plantain, sacha inchi, chirimoyas, grapes, and many more fruits and vegetables. The sun gives them solar energy to cook in the solar kitchen. And in contrast to an often exploitative exchange economy, neighbors give and receive gifts according to their needs and those of the children. The houses in Nachira were built with ecological friendly materials. All households are headed by women, since the houses were given to them. Many households are women only, like the households of Yarmile Perdomo. She has 7 children, and her first child she had it when she was 13. Her companion had to be expelled from Nachira because he had the habit of beating her every 15 days when he got drunk and he received his pay. In some cases, the eldest son or brother has taken the role of father, like this is the case with Elsie's family. Being an open-door community, children and the elderly are never alone. Some of the activities of the women of Nachira are making pottery, in some cases using the Malagana designs. Another group makes handmade paper and papier mache, while composting is done with the organic waste and the help of Californian worms. Other women proudly collect and recycle inorganic waste from the neighborhood. In an electric van given to them by the Palmira municipality, the recycled plastic, glass, and other inorganic materials are stored, sorted, and recycled as well. And some of them are used to make products of their own use. Free-range chicken, turkeys, and other birds are also part of the Nachira Sustainable Eco-Village. Removals are done in a horse-drawn carriage. All administrative decisions are taken by the women by consensus. The consumption of alcohol is not encouraged, and men who have incurred violent acts against their partners or children have been expelled. There is no crime in Nachira. Violence against women was eradicated, as Nachira is a community with open doors where women support each other and men have developed a new culture of love and respect for women. Child care and maintaining the eco-village are tasks shared through mingas or collective work. The floor of the Aguara, our meeting place, is one example. And the solar clock, which was made by the young people of Nachira, is another one. The founding of the Pachamama was also the result of collective work. And the composting toilet where walls were made with plastic bottles collected at the peace marches. In Nachira, we have held several seminars. The Matriarchal Circle in 2013, where Heidi Göttner-Abendroff was our main speaker. In 2019, we celebrated the publication of Genevieve Vaughan's book in Spanish, Para Donar, and the conference on the maternal gift economy and other alternative economies. We closed with a gratiferia, where people brought their gifts and others received it. What you see now here is the trio of gifts. Companies, women, men have been encouraged to give gifts to Nachira, and their names are recorded in leaves painted in the tree of gifts. Also, there are the names of those professionals or those people that belong to the time bank and give lectures, teach languages, give sexual education, legal advice, medical advice, free of charge. Ruby is a single mother, age 19. She's now studying law and is the first person in her family who goes to college, sent to the gift from the Ingenio Mayagüez. In its 80 years of existence, the Nachira Covilas has changed paradigms. Women are respected, and unwanted adolescent pregnancies are no longer the norm. Mothers do not need to essentially sell or see their daughters to richer neighbors for money, and violence against women has been largely eliminated. The exchange of resources through a practical application of the gift economy has helped to make extreme poverty a single device at a time when the COVID-19 pandemic has exposed the fragilities of today as a social structure. This ad was placed in a visible place in the Eco-Village at the time of the pandemic. If you don't have food to eat, place a white cloth in your door and we will help you. There is a subject which I must address. A question was asked about the way that the relationship between spirituality and sexuality was managed in a community run by women. Colombia being a Catholic country, the process was not easy. But the fact that women owned their houses and would allow both in her house and in her body only those persons that she wants, and also that from the beginning young girls took part in the Colombian government program of preventing teenage pregnancies by using contraceptives, mainly the Yadela device, contains the answer. I have consulted Lucy Littrup, an expert sexologist, and this is what she says based on her knowledge of Nachira. Sexuality is not only reproduction. The feminist independent woman owns her own body, not only for reproduction but also for pleasure. The human body is designed for both, the feminine bodies in particular. The clitoris is the only organ in the human species that has no other function than to provide pleasure. So the independent woman is free of a transactional economy when she owns her own body and she chooses when to share her body with a person, man or how. Therefore, the access to contraception gives the women the freedom to have pleasure. Being promiscuous is of course anybody's right, but part of independence is also the freedom to treat your body with respect. You don't have to pay for love with sex. You don't have to pay for economic safety. You don't have to pay with sex, marriage for someone, for social status. The woman's body is an economy of gifts. It's like Mother Nature in her body, and her body is sacred. If she has the independence, she can be free to treat her body as a sacred vessel for creation of life, but also of the sacred erotic union of love and pleasure with the person she chooses, be it a man or woman. When a woman owns her house, her own terreno, and has the freedom to take contraception, she is the master of who enters her house, both in a concrete and on a symbolic level. She decides who enters house and body.
Yo soy madre, cabeza de hogar. Y entonces como pues el arriendo es demasiado caro y uno para levantar la familia y todo eso es muy duro. Y nosotros vimos esto desocupado, muchas familias, y no nos atrevimos a ocupar este terreno. Y zancudos, malos olores, nos tenemos que aguantar los malos olores y todo eso, porque cuando crece el río también tenemos peligro. La bendición de Dios sería uno tener su casa. Uno piensa más que todo para los hijos, porque los hijos es la meta de uno.
En Colombia, el conflicto armado nace y permanece ligado a la generación y distribución de la riqueza y del poder político. La desigualdad económica ha profundizado las formas de sobrevivencia de la población. Como resultado de la guerra y el desplazamiento forzado de las zonas rurales a las zonas urbanas, las mujeres han entrado a conformar los cinturones de miseria de las ciudades, donde llegan con sus hijos o porque han quedado solas o porque han sido abandonadas como el resultado de la cultura machista que hace que los hombres sean esporádicos. El 33% de los hogares colombianos tienen a una mujer como cabeza de familia y los índices de pobreza indican que el 70% de las personas en pobreza extrema son mujeres que sobreviven con unos ingresos de un dólar diario. Por el hacinamiento y la pobreza, la violencia contra la mujer ha adquirido proporciones epidémicas y el embarazo de las adolescentes es un problema de nunca acabar.
En un predio de 3 hectáreas en el municipio de Palmira, en Colombia, 88 mujeres cabeza de familia vienen cultivando la tierra durante los últimos 6 años. Las mujeres han hecho sus propias huertas para tener seguridad alimentaria. Con la ayuda de artistas internacionales y un premio otorgado por un hábitat, los jóvenes de Nachira han elaborado el proyecto La Vida es un Teatro. Con retal de mosaico, las jóvenes han construido el piso del ágora o centro de encuentro y de recreación para niños y adultos, decorado con elementos alusivos a la ecoaldea. Muchas de las mujeres y jóvenes de Nachira vienen de áreas rurales que han sido afectadas por la violencia. Por eso, las mujeres de Nachira están en el proceso de generar un proyecto único y una comunidad ecológica, solidaria y sostenible.
Hace muchos años quedamos desplazados con mi familia y éramos pequeños y nos tocó llegar a la ciudad de Cali y vivir en un barrio de invasión donde la vida era muy insegura y pues había muchas dificultades. Ahora aquí me siento muy feliz de vivir aquí en la Coldea Nachira, compartiendo con mi familia, con mis padres, con los niños, con toda la Coldea, con toda la comunidad. Nos sentimos felices, aquí tenemos nuestra vivienda segura, tranquila.
Desde hace 12 años pertenezco a la Asociación Mujeres de Cabeza de Familia del proyecto Nachira. Eso hace que trabajamos por una mejor calidad de vida. Hoy vivo en mi casa con mi familia y soy muy feliz porque aquí conseguimos paz, tranquilidad y aire puro.
Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto. Me dio dos luceros que cuando los abro perfecto distingo lo negro del blanco y en el alto cielo su fondo estrellado y en las multitudes el hombre que yo amo. Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto, me ha dado el oído que en todo su ancho graba noche y día, grillos y canarios, martillos, turbinas, ladridos, chubascos y la voz tan tierna de mi bien amado. Gracias a la vida que me ha dado tanto, me ha dado el sonido y el abecedario. Con él las palabras que pienso y declaro, madre, amigo, hermano y luz alumbrando la ruta del alma del que estoy